LifeBridge Church started right here. Is there slides? Do you guys have slides? Yeah. LifeBridge Church started right here. In a church like many of yours, we had 80 people attending, with most of them in their 60s, 70s, and 80s. In fact, in the pastoral interview, the head deaconess had accidentally blurted, "If we don't get more young people in here, our church is going to die." Why would anyone have any reason to believe that 3.5 years later, that church would have 30 young adults passionately involved in ministry and send some of them to plant a new church 30 minutes south in the metro area? One of the most exciting things about church planting is that it is rooted in the undying belief that God can create something out of nothing. Do you believe God can do that through you? Jesus said, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." We started praying for Jesus to send out more young adult workers into his harvest field, and we began looking everywhere for how he was going to answer. We started a young adult Bible study group and worked to recruit every young adult we had ever seen in our lives into that group to grow relationally, spiritually, and missionally so they could become leaders in the mission. One young adult who came to that Bible study group, we started talking afterward. His name was Jed. Jed shared, "Now Jed had only visited my church one time, but I had run to him, connected with him, heard a slice of his story, gotten his contact info, and followed up just like I did with every young adult who ever crossed my line of vision." And so I was talking to Jed after this Bible study group, and he shared how he had recently bought a dental practice in the city to the south and wanted to reach his patients for Christ. I proceeded to tell him a story about a dentist I knew who had planted a church in order to reach his patients and employees in a powerful way. I ended the story by saying, "What if God did that through you?" Jed's eyes lit up. Jed had been church hopping. He had been spending some Sabbaths in the woods. He had grown up going to Adventist church and Adventist school his entire life. And yet this was the first time he had ever really considered church planting. A God-sized dream was born that day. Fast forward, Jed has led 5 of his patients and employees to baptism and active involvement in LifeBridge Church in the last year and a half. Some of our best future church plant leaders are young adults floating around waiting to be activated by your faith-based vision for multiplication. Jed and my side conversation about church planting turned into an active plan when I became part of an Acts church planter training residency. Our church sponsored a team of 5 young professionals to go to church planting boot camp down at the end of 2019. They came back with a church plant proposal and timeline, and we started prayerfully recruiting a core team to commit to planting a new church to reach unchurched young professionals in Tacoma, Washington. We looked for people who were hungry, humble, and smart. Hungry, they want to make a difference, passionate, motivated, and open to living missionally. Humble, strong character, high spirituality, and no personal agenda. Smart, emotionally intelligent, good judgment, and can handle responsibility. Also, bonus, highly recommended, although not required, is that they're young. They will add energy, passion, creativity, and cultural relevance. I wanted as many hungry, humble, and smart people as possible on the team, and I didn't want a single one who wasn't. I would take people out to eat and assess them, and then ask for a high level of commitment to weed out the people who just wanted to check out the new thing. The pastor of another Adventist church in the area collaborated to help the church plant. They offered their facility to us free of charge whenever they weren't using it. And that pastor personally met with some of his most committed young leaders and encouraged them to leave and go help the church plant. What if every Adventist pastor encouraged their most committed young leaders to go out and plant churches? What could happen for the kingdom of God? We started meeting together as a core team to connect and pray and lay out the vision with 20 young professionals and families in January 2020. We began learning how to live missionally in our everyday lives where we live, work, and play by blessing people, eating with people, listening to people, and praying for people. Every time we met, we would hold each other accountable by sharing stories of how we'd been living missionally that week.
we started to pray through what was our calling from God. We discovered that the calling of the church, according to Scripture, is to multiply disciples, leaders, groups, and churches, to be a multiplying movement. Then we started praying through how is God calling us to do this multiplication together. We studied the needs of the community. We studied the principles of Scripture, and we studied the gifts of the team, and that brought us together to how we were going to carry this out together. We determined that our primary focus group, we knew we would welcome everyone, but every church can only reach a certain kind of people, and we focused that into being unchurched, multi-ethnic young professionals and families in University Place, Washington. We were essentially going to invite them to journey with us to live a life that changes others forever. We would launch with three key ministries: health, family, and groups. We would say no to a lot of other good things so that we could be excellent in these three things. After laying out the vision, we were ready to activate ministry in spring of 2020. What happened in spring of 2020? The COVID pandemic. But instead of worrying about, instead of spending all of our energy on COVID protocol, we weren't even having worship gatherings yet. We focused all of it on how to be faithful to the mission. We threw all of our effort and resources into hosting a free dental clinic for the community where we were able to serve 100 people. Every patient received prayer with a LifeBridge team member. After Ashley's appointment, she sat down with Alex, who asked her about her life and what she could pray for. Ashley began to open up that her parents had taught her to believe in God and to pray, but she had never been to a church before in her life or never learned anything about the Bible. Now her kids were starting to ask spiritual questions, and she didn't know the answers. Alex got her contact info and began to follow up with a friendship. They'd go for walks together, share food, bless each other. And after a few weeks, Alex asked Ashley if she would like Bible studies. She said yes. But Alex is a multiplier. She understands that every opportunity in the mission is a chance to develop another disciple maker. So she didn't just do the Bible studies with Ashley herself. She got another family to come alongside and help with the Bible studies so they too could learn how to lead people to Christ in baptism. So we have older kids doing Bible studies with younger kids, teaching them about Jesus and the Bible for the first time in their life. We invited, Ashley's family began attending LifeBridge worship gatherings and getting involved. We asked Ashley to serve as a volunteer during our evangelistic series so she would be there and to host a follow-up Bible study group at her house. A couple months later, praise God, Ashley was baptized. Only a few weeks ago, Ashley served on the director team of our most recent dental clinic, and it was powerful to hear her share about how meaningful it was to serve at the same thing that had started her off in her journey with Jesus. Since that first dental clinic just over 2 years ago, LifeBridge Church has hosted 8 free health clinics, mobilizing 500 volunteers, serving 900 patients with over $400,000 worth of free health care. This is a church of about 50 members. How does this happen? It doesn't happen by preaching sermons, solving conflict, making hospital visits, running board meetings, or even doing Bible studies or conducting outreach trainings. This happens only through deeply investing in people who are hungry, humble, and smart, listening to their spirit-led dreams for impact, and helping them be successful in carrying them out and bringing other people along with them. Jesus said that his disciples and his followers would do greater things than he did as the Son of God. What if we as leaders follow Jesus' example and spent our best time developing people to do greater things than we ever will? Other Adventist churches have been inspired by our health clinics and have sent leaders to learn how they can implement them in their mission context. Let's be clear about something. Church plants don't hurt established churches. They help them learn how to become more effective in the mission. That after becoming more settled and established in pursuing our mission for a few months, we started gathering for worship once or twice a month, ramping up to a grand opening in January of last year. We had almost 100 people attend. It was amazing. We had arrived. The next week, we got word from the church we were renting from that said they had a memorial service that had to happen on Saturday morning in the auditorium so that we'd need to have ours in a classroom at a different part of the building. We pulled an audible, we arranged a kids program in another room to free up space, we set up 70 chairs and waited to see what God would do. Here's what LifeBridge Church looked like on week 2.
There's more people up front than there are sitting down. Not everything in ministry and church planting will go like we hope it will. But we just keep going. Jesus said, He will build. He said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. We don't need to be successful. We need to be faithful. But when we are faithful, He will make us successful. Here's what we focus on to make and multiply disciples with LifeBridge Church. We help people live missionally where they live, work, and play by praying for people, blessing people, eating with people, and listening to people. We know if we're leaning in relationally that that will result in spiritual conversations and opportunities to invite people to take next steps with Jesus. We organize a wave of groups for 8 weeks at a time. Lots of different groups meeting in different places and times, with every group has 5 goals: to help people grow relationally, grow spiritually, and grow missionally, to help at least one person move closer to baptism — we don't want a room just full of a bunch of Adventists — and to help develop at least one new leader who can lead a group in the next group's wave. Right? So then this group's wave leads up to an evangelistic series, a community Bible seminar, a reaping meeting, where we help people develop a biblical Adventist worldview and call for decisions to live into it, invite them to make decisions for baptism and follow Jesus. We follow that up with another wave of groups to help new members connect into groups, get more connected, build more friendships, invite their friends to start journeying with Jesus, and get involved in serving and being a blessing to others. We involve people in serving at any and every step in this process, and we repeat this cycle twice a year. This is what we've gone deep into. LifeBridge has celebrated over 20 baptisms, and by God's grace has not lost a single one. Several of these have come from unchurched backgrounds very far from God. Essence was a pot-smoking New Age spiritualist. She was the last person you would expect to see at a worship gathering or evangelistic series. But she did go to the dentist. And Jed and his team invited her to a health group they were hosting at their dental office as part of our group's wave. She came to the health group, and it helped her overcome alcohol for good, as well as make some new positive friends, like Veronica. Veronica invited Essence to go ice skating with LifeBridge and also to serve at a free vision clinic for people experiencing homelessness. Essence, along with 30 volunteers, arrived that morning to give free eye exams and prescription glasses to people experiencing homelessness, only to discover that the equipment had been stolen the night before. We gathered together and prayed, asking God for a miracle. If we want to see more miracles, all we have to do is get close to the people in our community who don't know God yet, because God will move heaven and earth to show them who He is. So we prayed for a miracle. We contacted a business in the nearby community and asked if we could borrow tens of thousands of dollars worth of equipment to use for that day. Prior attempts to partner with this business had failed. This time, they said yes. Within 1 hour, we had hauled the very expensive and very much nicer equipment to the facility, and we were able to serve over 100 people experiencing homelessness that day. Essence knew she'd been part of a miracle, but what shocked her the most was that when we had our prayer of thanksgiving right before beginning the clinic, the person responsible for losing the equipment said, "I think we need to pray for the person who stole this, because they're in the greatest danger." She went up to him after the clinic and said, "How could you say pray for the person who stole it? They're a terrible person." And he proceeded to take 1 minute to tell her about Jesus Christ, to tell her about the gospel. And that started a curiosity. Essence wanted to learn more about this Jesus and about these people from LifeBridge that were different than anyone else she'd ever met. She started attending LifeBridge worship gatherings and doing Bible studies with Veronica. She was part of a group that led to an evangelistic series. During that evangelistic series, meanwhile, she's still engaging in her New Age spiritualist practices, doing New Age dances, drinking hallucinogenic drugs, engaging in divination and occult-type practices. During that evangelistic series, finally, the Holy Spirit helped everything click for Essence, and she started to realize how the great controversy was going on in her own life. She went home and got rid of 3 trash bags full of crystals and other occult-type garbage. She asked us to pray, and we prayed for her over her occult tattoo for Jesus to decommission it and cover it with His blood. And only a couple months ago, Essence shared her powerful testimony and was baptized into LifeBridge Church. You want to know what Essence is doing now? She's sharing her story. She's learning to live missionally. She's hosting a Bible study group in her house, and she's invited other people. She served as the director of our most recent dental clinic in January. She met a patient there who she started discipling. She is now growing to be a multiplier. Jesus has changed Essence's life. God is working among us to multiply disciples, leaders, groups. And what about churches? Only 1 year out from grand opening, with only 70 people in attendance, the LifeBridge leadership team just unanimously voted to initiate our next church plant by the end of this year. We're excited to see what God has in store. Jesus is going all out in the mission, and he invites us to join us. God can create something out of nothing, and he wants to do it through you.